So today I will be starting on a new topic which are auxiliary views. These are used when the normal orthographic views will not give details about all the details of that particular 3D model. That's when we would be using auxiliary views as a secondary view in order to explain the real complex internal geometries about a 3D part. So still we are left with sectional views, torsions, threads and fasteners, GDNT and sectional views. So 9 and 10 is not most, it's mostly information than drawings. For auxiliary views, so when do we need auxiliary views? So sometimes standard orthographic projections. So for any 3D model, if you want to represent a 3D model in a 2D media, then we would be using the views, which are the orthographic views. But sometimes the orthographic views would not give enough detail or not to analyze or not to imagine that particular 3D part from the orthographic views. Sometimes it would be really difficult to analyze it. So that's when we would use the secondary views, which are called the auxiliary views, in order to show the details about those internal geometries. So these are generally drawn to represent an inclined surface or an oblique surface of its true size and shape. So let's see. So we had inclined surfaces, which we would be representing that inclined surface in your orthographic views as an inclined edge in one of the views and as a surface in the other two views. But that particular inclined surface that you would show in your orthographic views is foreshortened, right? So before, in orthographic projections, we had an inclined edge which would represent an inclined surface, and that particular inclined line would be represented as a surface in the other two views. That particular surface would not be of the true size and shape, right, in the views. So for auxiliary views, we would show that particular inclined surface of its true size, shape and true length of line segments. Everything would be shown when we go about drawing auxiliary views. So when we want to show something of true size and shape, then that's when we would be using auxiliary views. So these are often used in sheet metal and packaging industries. They are created by looking directly onto the surface. So let's say I have an inclined line. So if I'm looking directly onto that inclined surface, whatever that I would be seeing needs to be drawn from that particular angle. So it provides true length of line segments, true angle between surfaces and lines, and true shape of surfaces. So how to get an auxiliary view? Let me explain using an example. So we would get auxiliary views for inclined surfaces drawn from either any of the views, from a view where you would see that inclined edge. So if I have my orthographic views that are given, so if these three are my orthographic projections, and I'm asked to sketch an auxiliary view, so depending on where you would see that inclined surface or oblique surface as an inclined line, so here I have that inclined surface represented as an inclined line in my front view. So if I want to show the true size shape of this particular inclined surface, then I would add auxiliary views apart from these three views. So in order to get your auxiliary view, you would need to first select an inclined edge, and then you would transfer the depth or width or height depending on where you are having that auxiliary view projected from. So let's say I'm trying to draw an auxiliary view from the front view. That means if I have an inclined edge in my front view, apart from my front view, what is common between these two? Either width, depth or height. Which one is common between
top
and side?
Depth.
The depth is common. Right? So if I am trying to draw an auxiliary view from the front view, my depth would be projected from the remaining two views. But when you are going about auxiliary views, you only require two. Because you either get your depth from top or the side. So if I am just given two views, I can still be able to draw the auxiliary. So let's say I just have the front and side. And I'm asked to sketch the auxiliary view for that particular inclined surface. So my first step would be I would select that inclined line and I would draw a parallel line parallel to that inclined line. And then I would project all and each and every corner perpendicular to that parallel line. So something like that. I would explain this in detail when I go over an example. So this is where I would have my auxiliary view and this would be my depth. I would show this in an example. Alright, so this is the first case. So if I have an auxiliary view, or if I want to sketch an auxiliary view from the top view, I'm not really concentrating on whether they would make sense or not. So if these three are my orthographic views, and if I'm asked to sketch auxiliary view projected from the top view, so that means if I have an inclined edge on my top view, I would use that inclined edge to show the true size shape of that inclined surface in my auxiliary view. So if I am using that particular thing, what is common between these two? So the height is common. So if I am trying to draw an auxiliary view projected from the top view, then I would have my height projected or taken from these two views, and then you would use that in your auxiliary view. So this is the second case. Third case would be if you have an inclined line in your side view. So if you are trying to draw an auxiliary view projected from the side view, I mean, if you have an inclined line in your side view, then you would have the auxiliary view or the auxiliary view shown in order to show the true size and length of that particular inclined surface. So what is common between these two? Width is common. Alright, so if I am trying to draw an auxiliary view projected from the side view, then I would have my width transferred from any of the remaining two views. So these are the three different cases where you would be able to draw the auxiliary views, which are the secondary views additional from these three views, to give even more further details about that particular 3D object. This is generally done when the 3D model has little complex internal geometries, or if you want to show the true size of the line segments from an inclined surface. So let's see an example. This is the same thing that I have discussed just a while ago. So auxiliary views projected from the front view. In this particular example, so you would be only given two orthographic views. So this is my front view and that's my top view. And if you are asked to sketch the auxiliary view projected from the front view, then you would need to select, so the first main step is you would need to select an inclined line. So in this case, there are two inclined lines. That means you can have two auxiliary views drawn for this particular example. But if you are asked to just sketch one, then you can just use one. So I have my depth that would be transferred, because this is auxiliary view from the front view, then I would have my depth transferred from the top or the side, whichever is given. So in this case, I have my top, so I would take my depth information from the top and then I would use it in my auxiliary view. So first main step is you would select the incline edge, you would draw a parallel line parallel to that incline edge, and you would project each and every corner point from the front view perpendicular to that parallel line that you have drawn. Then you would use the depth information from the top view, project it in your auxiliary view, and complete the auxiliary view. So I would explain everything using an example. So just remember that these are the main rules when you are going aboard an auxiliary view from the front. So to find the incline edge, LOS means line of sight. So your line of sight is perpendicular to that incline, perpendicular or onto that surface. That means you are looking at that particular angle. At that particular angle, whatever that you would be seeing, you will need to show in your auxiliary view. For these three orthographic views, we were just looking perpendicular to one side of the face of the cube, right? For orthographic views. But for auxiliary views, you would need to, your line of sight would be perpendicular to that particular incline surface that you have selected to show your auxiliary view for. So you need to project all the corner points parallel to the line of sight, and you would transfer the depth from either top or side, whichever is given. So this is the first case. So the second case is auxiliary view projected from the side view. So if you have your views that are given, so this is my front view that is given, and I have my side view. If I'm asked to sketch auxiliary view from the side view, then I would need to select an incline edge, and then my line of sight would be perpendicular to that surface, and you would project all the corner points perpendicular to that incline edge or perpendicular to the parallel line that you have drawn, and you would transfer your width information from the front. So when you go about the side, you would transfer the width either from the front or the top, whichever is given. So this is auxiliary view from the side. The third case is auxiliary view from the top view. So I have my front view, I have my top view. If I ask to sketch auxiliary view from the top view, then I would need to select an incline edge, which is that, then that would be parallel line to that incline edge. I would project everything. And here I would transfer the height information either from the front or the side view, whichever is given, and I would complete my auxiliary view. So there would be so many different possibilities depending on how the question is being asked. You would need to use that. I would explain each and every step in detail using an example. So let's open page I-9 on your workbook, and this is the first drawing on page I-9. I've just increased the size. I-9. Okay, so here I'm asked to sketch auxiliary view projected off the front view. So if that is my front view, this would be my side view, and I'm asked to sketch the auxiliary view projected off the front view. So I would need to select an incline edge, which would be my first step. So once I select my incline edge, then I would need to draw a parallel line. So these dotted lines that are given are just for the reference. Do not use those, sometimes they would be a little off. You would still use the dimensions from the side view and then use your compass to locate that particular thing. So you need your protractor and compass in order to complete your auxiliary views. Make sure that you purchase them as soon as you can. They are available at the Dollar Tree store, both is $1. So this is my front side. First step, select an incline edge. And you need to draw a parallel line, parallel to this inclined line. So at a certain distance. That particular distance, it's up to you. You can pretty much place it anywhere that you like. So When you are going about drawing a parallel line, you need to use triangles and rulers. Does anyone have a triangle? So I have this. I would have a ruler. So I would first locate my scale or ruler right there. I would have my triangle and then I would just move it so that I can draw another parallel line. Right? So we just have to the first step is selecting an inclined line and I would draw a parallel line parallel to that inclined edge. You would use triangle and a ruler and then you would get that parallel line drawn. So make sure that this parallel line is a little large, longer than the actual drawing. The next step, so I've drawn my parallel line. So my next step would be projecting each and every corner from the view where you want your auxiliary view to be shown. So here I have this corner, that corner, all the corners from the front view needs to be projected perpendicular to that parallel line that you have drawn. For that you will need to use your protractor and locate 90 degrees at each and every corner point and then get those things, get those lines drawn. So if I say this corner point, then I would locate my protractor right there, locate 90 degrees and draw a line which is 90 degrees or perpendicular to this line. All the corner points. My lines are not really straight here, but I will show it. Once you get your projection lines, then you would need to analyze what each surface would be represented in these two views. Then you would transfer your depth information from the side onto your auxiliary views. So let me get that drawn on here. So you can pretty much follow me. That would be my parallel line parallel to the incline line that's selected, and I will project each and every corner perpendicular to the circuit, the incline line. Those are the two steps. First step, parallel line parallel to that inclined line, and then I would project everything perpendicular to that line starting from each and every corner of that front view. Now let's analyze these two views, what they would represent. So if I have an inclined line right here, in my front view, that inclined line should be represented as a surface in my side view. If you want, you can use projection lines, try to understand what that would represent. So surface A is an inclined surface which is represented by that inclined line in my front view. So if I have my 1, 2 here, 1, 2 would be at that particular point, right? And then 5, 6 would be right there, 3, 4 would be right here. And I have another normal surface here which is represented by this vertical line. So that is 3 and 4, let's say this is a 7 and 8. So my 7 would be here and 8 would be right there. Similarly, I have a horizontal line right here which would represent a normal surface either in your top view or a side view. So let's say if I have a horizontal line in my front view, that should represent a surface in my top view and a horizontal line in my side view. So this horizontal line which is beyond would represent that particular surface. So let's label all those with respect to what they would represent in these two views. So at this particular point I would have my 1 and 2, right? And from right there I would have my 5, 6 and I would have my 4 and 3 right there. You guys have any questions on how did I locate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? So it's an inclined surface. So I have an inclined surface. If it has 2 points from the side view, when I'm looking from the front, those 2 points will be at the same location. And if I say this as 7 and that as 8, my 7 and 8 would be at that point. Right? If I say from the front view, if I said that as 9 and 10, my 9 would be at 1 and 10 would be at 2. Right? So analyzing these views is really important. So if you analyze everything correctly, then you can get your auxiliary view projected easily. You guys have any questions on how did I locate those corner labels? Alright, so let's start with 1. Before that, let me draw another line right there. So draw a line right here. This particular line would represent the same line as that when you are transferring the depth information. Now you will need to use your compass in order to take the depth information from the side view and locate it in an auxiliary view. So for that, so one is right there on that front face, let's say front face in this case. This will represent the same thing as this. So if one is right there, let's say zero depth. 1 and 2 are on that projection line, so my 1 would be right there. If I take 2, so the depth of 2, you would use your compass, take that depth information, and then you would locate it on there, on the same projection line. So let me do it here. Oh. Does anyone have a question? Okay. So my 1, 2 is right here, on this particular projection line. So if I have this line which is representing the same as this, 1 is located on that line. So 1 would be right there. And my 2, I would use my compass, take that particular depth, I would go right here, and then I would mark my 2. On the same projection line, because 2 is on this projection line. So if this is 6 and that is 5, 6 is on that line. 5, 6 and this is 4, 3. So my 5, 6 is on that particular projection line, 6 is right there, so 6 is on this line, so my 6 will be right here. And 5 is on this projection line, the depth of 5, use your compass, locate that, and then you locate it on the projection line that you are using, and you locate 5. Same thing for 4 and 3. For 4, so 4 is right here and 3 is here. So in order to get your depth information, you would take your depth information from this particular line. So you would take your depth information of 4 here, use the projection line and locate 4. Take same thing for 3 on the same projection line and you locate 3. So once you get all those corners for that particular surface A, so 1 and 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, 6 and 1. So that would be my surface A. You guys have any questions on how will I locate this? No. Alright, so let's move on to the next surface from the side view, which is, let's say this is surface B. And it has corner labels 4, 3, 7 and 8. So my 7 and 8 would be right here. I already located my 4, 3 in my auxiliary view. I would need to locate 7 and 8. Here it's a vertical line that is representing a normal surface. So when you are going about auxiliary view, your line of sight would be perpendicular to that inclined edge that you have selected. So that means I'm looking at that particular angle. When I look at that particular angle, whatever that you would be seeing needs to be shown in your auxiliary view. So when I look at that particular angle, I would see a tiny little part of this edge, right? And also that edge, when I'm looking that at that angle, I would see this surface and that surface, apart from that inclined line. So I would need to show those two surfaces in my auxiliary view as well. So 4, 3, 7, 8 is surface B. 4, 3 is already located. Let's look at 7 and 8 using compass. So I would take the depth information of 7. So 7 and 8 is on that projection line. So I will locate my 7. So which would be right there. And 8 is on the same projection line. Take the depth of 8 and transfer it on to the auxiliary view. So once you get all those four corners, so this surface is representing surface B. But when I'm looking at that particular angle, this is how I would be seeing. So in this case, you would have your inclined surface shown of true size and shape, but your normal surfaces would be foreshortened. So the main reason for having these views drawn is so that you would be able to see that inclined surface of true size and shape. So this inclined surface in your side view has been foreshortened, it's not of the true size, but in your auxiliary view it would be of the true size and shape. So similarly, this particular surface is visible and we label this as 9 and 10. My 9 would be right here and 10 would be here. So I would get my depth information of those here from here and I would use projection line. So 9 and 10 is on this projection line. So 9 is right there, so 0 depth. So this is gonna be my 9. 10, use your compass, locate that depth and then you mark your 10. Once you locate those,
you want to erase the other lines?
Yeah, you erase it after you're done. Make sure that these lines are real thin. So projection lines always are drawn thin and object lines would be drawn thick. You guys have any questions so far? So I pretty much completed that particular edge, the first edge that I would be seeing when I'm looking at that particular angle. But in your auxiliary view, you would need to show hidden features as well. So can you guys visualize based off these two views on how your 3D model is going to look like? I'll try my best to draw it neat. guys visualize it. It's gonna look like 7. And then from the front view, when I'm looking from this angle, this surface and that surface is visible. Alright, so. It's not a thing right there. Anyways, visualize the 3D model based on the views. Alright, so I would have my auxiliary view drawn when I'm looking straight onto that inclined surface. So this is my surface A. So I'm drawing everything that I would be seeing from that particular angle. So when I see straight onto that surface, I would see this, I would see this, I would see that. I've shown those three surfaces, 1, 2, and 3. Depending on the depth information from the side. Also, I will need to show all the hidden features in my auxiliary. So when I'm looking at that particular angle, do you think I would see the edge that is going from here to the back face? Alright, so if this is 5, that is 6, that is 1, 2, this is 9, 10, this is 4, 3, and that is 7 and 8. So these are all the labels that we have used. So this particular edge, when I'm looking from that particular angle, so if I set that as 11 and something behind 5 as 12, so let me draw that using the lines. So my 5, 12 from the front view, so 11 and 12 would be right here, my 11 would be right here and 12 would be right there, right? From the side view, 6 and 11 at the same point, 5, 12, the same point. When I'm looking from the front, 11, 12 would be at the same point, 5 and 6 would be at the same point. But can you guys visualize it? Do you guys have any questions on how did I locate 11 and 12? Alright, so when I'm looking at that particular angle, will I be able to see this edge? No, right, it should be shown as a hidden line. So I would need to locate 11 and 12 first in my auxiliary view. And then I would use my hidden lines to represent whatever that is hidden from that particular plane of sight. So 11 and 12 are on that projection line. My 11 is here, so that means on this, it has zero depth, so that would be my 11. And 12, take, use your compass, get that depth information and transfer it. So that would be my 12. Now, my 11 and 12, when I'm looking at that particular angle, that particular edge is hidden. So I would not be able to see this edge, that is 11 and 12. So I would need to show it as hidden line. So just from 11 and 12, I would show a hidden line that would pretty much represent this edge in my 3 isometric drawing. Still, when I'm looking at that particular angle, even this edge is hidden. So I would not be able to see that particular edge. 12 to 5. So draw another hidden line from 12 to 5. From that angle, even this edge kind of would be hidden, right? So when I'm looking at that angle, this edge would not be visible because this edge would be sitting on top of that. But 11 and 6, so 11 and 6, I already have an object line, so I don't have to show a hidden line on top of an object line. So if you have an object line, you don't have to show it again, or you don't have to erase it. If you don't have anything, that's when you would show it as a hidden line. So in this case, there's nothing that would represent that particular edge. So I would need to show it as a hidden line. You guys have any questions? Nope. Alright, so what else would be hidden from that particular angle? Is there any edge apart from those? For the whole 3D isometric drawing, that would be, that is not visible. Can you guys see this edge? That's at the, on the back face, like the bottom face. So this is my bottom, right? So if I, oh no, if I did that, then you will get confused. So from pretty much this edge, or this corner. So that is hidden as well. So that particular corner and that edge would not be visible from that particular angle. So I would need to show that particular edge as hidden line in my auxiliary view. Or to be so you don't know what is hidden, what is not hidden, depending on, so if you're not able to visualize it that good. So make sure that each and every projection line that you have projected from here or from the front view, we have used that in some or the other way. So in this case, we are yet to use this particular projection line. So that means I would need to show that particular corner either as a object line, either or a hidden line, depending on whether it is visible or hidden. So in this case, when I'm looking at that particular angle, I don't have anything from this point to this point, right? So the bottom edge is just from that depth, which is beyond 7 and 8. So if I set that as so let's say that as 13 and 14. My 13 and 14 would be right here, right? So in the 3D isometric drawing, 7 and 8. At 7, that would be my 13. At 8, that would be my 14, right? So when I'm looking at that particular angle, 13, 14 edge is hidden. So we need to show 13, 14 as hidden. So 13, 14 is on that projection line. I would get my depth information for 13 and 14. So that would be my 13 and that would be my 14. I would need to show it as a line. Guys, have any questions so far? Let me make those. Any questions? Alright. So what about this particular edge? When I'm looking from that particular angle, it's still hidden. So 14 and 8. But 14 and 8 is already represented as an object line, so we don't have to show another hidden line now sitting on top of it. Even 13 and 7, so from 13 to 7. I already have this edge which is represented as hidden, and that is an object line, so I don't have to show a line on top of another line, right? So any questions at any point of this drawing? No. So this completes our auxiliary. So let me write the steps. So when you go about auxiliary views, my first step would be selecting an inclined line from a view. So depending on where your inclined line is, I would select that view. So if your question says I would need an auxiliary view projected off the front view, then you would select your front view, and from your front view you would select an inclined line. So that would be your first step. Second step would be drawing a parallel line which is parallel to the inclined line selected, which is this particular line. Step 3 would be projecting each and every corner point
perpendicular to
so you project all the corner points, that means perpendicular to the parallel line drawn. So this is my parallel line, and I would project each and every corner point perpendicular to that line. Step 4 would be, you would analyze what each surface is represented in your orthographic views. You would analyze the orthographic views and get your corner labels projected accurately with respect to what they would represent in these two views. Then once you get all those corner labels done, step 5 would be to take either with or height information from the view and transfer onto auxiliary. So you either take width, depth or height information depending on what views are given and what with what view you are having that auxiliary view shown. So we take, in this case we are transferring the depth information onto the auxiliary view depending on how deep it is. So once you get all those transferred, you would show everything and also show, so step 6 would be show hidden features. This is my steps for analysis for auxiliary views. Make sure that you understand how to use those, and let me explain what other examples that we have. So that completes my auxiliary view. We have other drawings on the same page. So make sure that you understand those steps and try to utilize it here. So my second drawing, I would have my auxiliary view projected off the top view and my front view is given. So I would transfer the height information onto the auxiliary view. So I would select that incline edge, draw a parallel line, I would project everything perpendicular to that, and I would get my height information for each and every corner, analyze it, and then I would locate each and every corner point to complete that auxiliary view. In this case, it is from side view, so I would draw that parallel line, project everything, and here I would get my width information, and I would locate my width information and complete this. So you need to complete, for the homework, you need to complete page I-10. All the four drawings on page I-10 need to be completed. This is due next Monday. Here in this case, make sure that so there are no dotted lines. So you need to come up with your own lines and complete these auxiliary views. So complete all those four, and I would go about another example in the next class so that you can understand it much better. So this is a homework. If you want to take picture, you can. If you don't have any questions, I'll see you guys next class.